Hey guys, Corbin here. In the last video, I talked about setting up the hardware for my automatic tool changer, or ATC. In this video, I'm going to talk about my ATC tool rack. I'll first discuss some considerations on where to put the rack. Then I'll cover some experiments with 3D printing a rack. Finally, I'll go over machining my own tool rack out of wood, something you could do for your own machine for really cheap. So where to put the tool rack? I have a 4-foot by 8-foot machine, and where I decide to put the tool rack could potentially cause me to lose some of my cutting area. My general goal was to be able to cut a full 4-foot by 8-foot sheet of plywood without losing any cutting space. And I'll show you how to do that, but also show you what I ended up doing. So consider this as a generic 4-foot by 8-foot table. You could put the rack in the front at the Y min, or you could put the rack at the back at the Y max. You could put the rack at the left at the X min, or at the right on the X max. Now, if you have a 10-foot machine, then just put the rack at the back of the table at the Y max and don't worry about it. Similarly, if you have a 5-foot wide machine and you only want to cut a 4-foot wide piece of plywood, then you could just put your rack on the side of the machine. For everyone else, I'm going to discuss the 4 basic positions you could put it and the orientation of the rack for each option. Now, the orientation of these little tool forks might affect your decision on where to put the rack and which way to face it. So for any given position on where you're going to put the rack, the forks could be pointing one of two ways, this direction or this direction, or if it's on the side, left or right. If you have a dust boot, then you have to consider what will happen when you do a tool change. There are a few basic options on what you can do. You can dock the dust boot somewhere before you do a tool change and pick it up after, so it has to be attached with magnets. Or you can use pneumatics or motors to lift it up out of the way or move it to the side before the tool change happens. Or you can use a slim dust boot that fits over the tool rack and stays on while you do the tool change. A slim dust boot is the easiest option, and it's what I decided to do. I designed this dust boot specifically to work with an ATC, and I'll share the CAD files so you can download it and 3D print your own. You can also purchase one pre-made, and I'll link to where you can do that. Now, even a slim dust boot has some limitations, but I can get 10 tools in a 4-foot wide table with my slim design. But if you were to dock the dust boot before you did a tool change, then you could have the tools be even tighter and closer together, and you could fit more in. So it's just something to consider. The slim dust boot and the spindle orientation cause some limitations on how you can actually do the tool change. The boot has more space in the front to allow it to drop over the tool holder and actually perform the change without hitting anything. In addition, since the spindle is on the front side of the gantry, the motion to pick it up has to be from the back to the front. And this simply is because if we were to turn the dust boot around and trying to do it the other way, it would hit the gantry and not work. So what this means is the orientation of the tool forks have to be pointing away when they're on either the front or the back end of the machine at the Y min or the Y max. If you put the tool rack on one of the sides, then you can simply twist the dust boot to the side and have it pick it up on whichever way you want. So the orientation is a little less important. However, the physical location of your dust hose and which side it goes off to in your machine may cause it to have a better orientation. For me, it goes over to the right, so if I were to have my tool rack on the left side, the dust boot would be way further to the left and it would kind of get caught in things. So for me, it would make more sense to have the tool rack be on the right-hand side if I wanted it on one of the sides. So the next consideration is the maximum tool height that you may be using. I was considering using some of these 3D printed tool pocket holders, and they're good to illustrate some of the problems. Basically, you can't have your tool holder be too high where it would actually hit the gantry if the gantry has to move over it. So that really limits how high you can put it. So if you're going to have your tool holders over the MDF spoil board, your bit heights are severely limited. The obvious way to work around this is to have the bits hang over the back of the spoil board so they have plenty of room for large bit heights. Potentially, the best rack position is in the front of the machine. You won't have any limitations with the gantry actually hitting the tool holders, so you can put them up really high and have no issues with the bits colliding with anything. Advantage of this is it will be completely higher than your spoil board, allowing you to still get a 4-foot by 8-foot sheet of plywood underneath it and not obstruct anything. Now, I decide against this for several reasons. I rarely cut plywood, and if I do, I'm okay with losing some space along the 8-foot length because it just doesn't matter to me. I wanted to reserve the front of my machine for two accessories, which I actually don't even have yet. I would like to have a vertical work table right here, and I would also like to have a rotary axis in this hole here. So for me, the best location for the rack was at the back of the machine. Initially, I was going to use some 3D printed tool rack holders. I designed these in CAD, and I'll share a link to them in case you actually want to use them yourself. I did some strength test failures, and I felt like they broke a little bit too easily, and I was worried that they might break just due to a tool change for some reason, so I decided against using them. Some people have designed some awesome sheet metal tool racks, and I'll put links in the description where you can get a few of them. They look awesome, and if you want a turnkey solution, I recommend buying one of those, but they could be up to $800. Since they are so expensive, I decided I wanted a cheap solution, so I designed this tool rack out of wood. I'll put a link in the description for the Fusion 360 file and also an SDL so you could machine your own. Now, mine is made out of a piece of pine that I had laying around. I grabbed a piece of rough stock, milled it flat, and it came out to about 2 inches thick. I think it would be better to make one out of hardwood, like cherry or maple, and that was my initial plan, but so far I really haven't had any issues with the softwood one, so I'm continuing to use it. One thing I did do is I oriented the grain at a 45-degree angle, and that way the rack would be less likely to break on either of the axes, meaning pulling up or pushing sideways. So I machined the rack, first by putting it on its side and cutting out the main profile. I wanted to avoid cutting my spoil board, so I did put some blue tape underneath. I carefully measured it, and I used the touch-off plate to touch off the top of my piece. For clamping, I just looked at the model and ensured that I clamped in a spot where it would not be cutting out. The height of my tool rack requires it to be on one sheet of MDF sticking above your base aluminum extrusion table. My spoilboard table design, it has two sheets of MDF, and so I actually trimmed off one sheet of the MDF and have the rack sitting on that portion. The rack is simply screwed on with soft pocket hole screws. That's really it. They have large heads, kind of with a washer, and they hold it down really well. I did pre-drill it to avoid splitting. Once I had it mounted, I could use the CNC machine to mill the top entirely flat. I didn't write any G-code for this, I just turned on the spindle and manually jogged it across the top a few times, and that's it. Next, I zeroed out the top of the rack using my Heimer 3D sensor. I also found the X and Y position on it. You could just use the Avid touch plate, that would work fine too. I then used my model to drill precise locations for the tool forks that I'm using. I have two different styles I'm using, so there's two different hole types depending on where it is. When I tried to screw them down initially, they were kind of rotating too much, so I did machine a small hole in the center to align this particular style. Some other styles have little nubs on them, and I could just machine holes in those to fit them accurately. It still did rotate a little bit when I was trying to put it on, so I just used a 1-2-3 block behind it to hold it pretty straight as I screwed it on. So in the CAD file, I'll have two different types of tops depending on the type of tool fork that you're using. And I'll put some links in the description to kind of elaborate on which is which. So that's really it for building the tool rack. In the next video, I'm going to cover the software side of things using Mach 4 to set everything up and to start doing automatic tool changes. Thanks, everyone.